I love this quote, a bird in a gilded cage. It is to live in luxury, but without freedom. But I believe, and many wise people think this way too, that freedom is the ultimate luxury. It trumps financial, social status, material items, wealth and riches, good looks and style. Sometimes those that live a life of shallow luxury miss out on the freedom. After all, a bird in a gilded cage is still trapped in a cage, can't spread its wings and soar, can't fly high and explore the beautiful things life has in store for it. All it can do is chirp about, and if lucky enough, has some company of fellow caged birds to tweet with all day, gossiping and pluming their feathers to show off. I think this idea and this illustration is an amazing parallel to the iconic movie called The Women. In this video, I will review the original 1939 film adaptation and the 2008 adaptation, drawing connections and comparisons, discussing themes and characters I find fascinating, all connected to the concept of feminism, patriarchy, and of course the importance of celebrating women, all women. Happy International Women's Day, Mother's Day, and Women's Month. Freedom as a word is defined as an exemption from external control, interference, regulation, and the power to determine action without restraint. In The Women, both versions, the women are so accustomed to the comfortable, white, privileged American life. Happily married, they have their help to cook and clean for them, spend their days shopping and pampering, take regular trips on holiday, and host parties worth a year's salary for some people. Doesn't that sound so great, so easy, so stress-free? Newsflash, life is not a fairy tale, even for the upper class. Men cheat, mistresses get what they want, wives get dumped, children get put to the side, and friends betray. The feeling of contentment is ephemeral. Living in abundance is a mindset. But the women know nothing about this. They live in their golden gilded cages and truly feel that nothing bad can happen in their life. Well, not until it happens. And then the survival instinct kicks in. There are those that fight for what they want and those that rest on their laurels. The lead character of The Women, Mary Haynes, played by the romantic Normashearer in the 1939 version, and by the remarkable megryan in the 2008 version, does the latter. Resting on your laurels is to appear to be satisfied with the things you have achieved and have stopped putting effort into what you are doing. I would say that this statement is the character flaw and really the arc of the character journey that will be overcome by Mary. Mary Haynes has the big house, the help, the providing husband, the well-off family, the cute daughter, and access to the luxury that New York City has to provide. But one thing is for sure, she as an individual is not living up to her potential. It's as though she has lost herself along the way and lives in her comfortable title as wife, mother, and occasional socialite. The Women, 1939, is a comedy drama directed by George Cukor, based on The Women, a 1936 play written by Claire Booth Luce. The rather lengthy, drawn-out screenplay was written by Anita Luce and Jane Murfin. The 2008 version, a modern retelling, feels more crisp in the plotline and was directed and written by Diane English, based on the previous material of The Women. The two films mirror one another in terms of plot and characters, but obviously the generational gap is clear in the concept of style and dialogue. The women are so out of touch with reality, we can't help but feel sorry for their naivety. Mary Haynes' naivety and virtuosity makes her act rather sad than angry after finding out that her loving provider husband of 13 years and father to their daughter goes behind her back and cheats on her with the seductive and manipulative Crystal Allen. Crystal has got the successful, handsome, yet midlife crisis and balding Mr. Haynes wrapped around her finger. Can you imagine the horror Mary felt finding out that her husband not only has been cheating on her, but with some lowly, trashy perfume counter clerk? Oh, the shivers Mary must have felt in her upper-class, wasp, suburban housewife body. There are four big pillars of relationships women experience and learn in life. Motherhood, the experience to be a mother, but also the experience of being a daughter to your mother. Female friendships, romantic relationships, men, and the final one, which is really the overarching theme for the women, but also in real life, and that is your relationship to yourself from a career and self-expression mindset. These four pillars are touched on in the women and show the complexities of living life as a woman. We can see that although quite a lot has changed since 1939, even since 2008, the message of the women is still relevant. My favorite part about the women, and this is shared between the two movies actually, is the cast. I simply adore the ensemble cast in both films. Really fabulous actresses, so talented, distinguished, and iconic. Normashearer and megryan play the 1939 and 2008 lead character of Mary Haynes. Joancrawford and evamendes play Crystal Allen, and Rosalindrussell and Annette Bening as Sylvia Fowler. Essentially, we follow the story of Mary Haynes' disintegration of her marriage after she finds out that her husband has been cheating on her for a while from a manicurist who knows and spreads all of the gossip. With the guidance of her friends and family, she sets out on a journey of not only coming to terms with the situation, but also self-discovery. At the start, she opts for a simple, non-flashy nude nail polish. But at the end, she rocks the jungle red on her talons, symbolizing her new bold self-image. From a quiet white dove to a bird of prey. Motherhood. It's nice to know you still need your mama. In both films, the mother and daughter relationship between Mary and her mother, and also her own relationship to her daughter, is very realistic and powerful. I hadn't seen such a truthful mother-daughter dynamic on screen before. The openness to talk about relationships, divorce, infidelity, and aging is a great example of a healthy dynamic between mother and daughter. This honesty and compassion between Mary and her mother is transferred into Mary and her teenage daughter's relationship. Mary's daughter is very young, just entering her teens, and now more than ever, that influence of a caring and open mother is needed. It is really hard to know what to do and where to go during hardships without a mother figure in your life, someone to confide in. This movie made me realize that not everyone has this priceless person in their life, and it should not be taken for granted. Simply by just being there for your daughter, no matter how old she is enough, and that advice and unconditional love cannot be forged or found in any other person. Friendship. But something that is found and forged is female friendships. It is an integral experience to girlhood and womanhood, having to operate and nurture friendships with other women. In the women, the cattiness and pettiness and gossiping nature of many women is highlighted through how women talk about one another behind each other's backs. People love to be involved from a distance and snoop around other people's business. Mary's friends can't help it, even if it comes from a place of love and protection of their friend. The notion of what it means to be a girl's girl and what it means to promote and follow the rather abstract and elusive notions of the female code, of the female codex, is a common thread in the women. Crystal Allen is not a girl's girl. She's out there to claim what's not hers, regardless of who she hurts. This is a cutthroat way of going after what you want. But even then, we notice that Crystal has no friends. In fact, women avoid her. She's overtly sensual, striking in looks and behavior, and that actually annoys other women. Mary, on the other hand, has a strong bond with her group of female friends. They look out for one another, despite all going through hardships of their own. That is why friendships can become toxic when resentment, competition, and lack of communication kicks in. Just like a romantic relationship, friendships need communication, and sometimes friendships don't last, and that's okay too. Friendships can be sacred, but toxic too. Men should be complimentary to you, loyal and devoted. Prioritize yourself, but be open to love. Don't idolize your partner, and don't put them on a pedestal over you. These are the main takeaways of the woman. It takes Mary a while to get to this mindset after moping around with desperation, but she gets there. In the 1939 version, Mary Haynes ultimately divorces Mr. Haynes, and he actually remarries Crystal. Whereas in the 2008 version, Mary doesn't get around to filing and finalizing the divorce, even though Mr. Haynes starts living with Crystal. The ending is the same though in both versions, and that is that Mary gives her husband a second chance. What can I say? She loves him. She can't change that feeling. Throughout both of the movies, Mary reconfirms her true love to her husband, despite her pain and anger. Mr. Haynes too confirms his love for her after not being satisfied with Crystal after a while. Clearly, this man is having a midlife crisis because Mary's undying love for him, she gives their relationship another shot. And I think this is a satisfying and realistic ending. Women, more often than men, take their partner back after cheating. Cheaters almost always come back, and Mary leaves that door unlocked. I prefer the ending in the 2008 version, as it is left ambiguous as to whether they will reunite. Whereas in the 1939 version, and I suppose it is because of the time, gender roles at that time, that Mary not only forgives her husband, but ends the movie's closing shot practically running in an open embrace to her husband. It's got that golden age of Hollywood melodramatic edge. The idea of men and their influence on women is prevalent in this film, and it teaches us to put yourself first and not the man. In Sylvie's case, men feel threatened by her power and success that she finds it hard to find a true connection. So put yourself on a pedestal. Don't bend over backwards for a man who most certainly would not do the same for you. Career, self-realization. Unfortunately, being a good person with good morals, actions, thoughts, a good heart does not mean that you deserve what you want. It does not mean that because you are good, the people who enter your life will be good to you too, who will respect you and value you. We see that when Mary takes her dormant career back into motion, when she changes her style and truly puts herself, her dreams first, that is when new opportunities, new and exciting people come into her life. She blossoms. It does certainly take some outside voices to motivate Mary to do what she wants to do, stop people pleasing and stop putting herself first. We watch Mary go from a doormat who essentially gets her fuel of self-confidence from the attention and affection of a man to fueling her tank of self-love, self-acceptance and confidence through taking time for herself, enjoying her transformation and enjoying her work. Often in love, in marriage, in relationships, women abandon their dreams, put aside some things to accommodate for their partner and their children. Ladies, make something of yourself. Make your dreams come true. Mary did when she launched her fashion brand. Women don't need to be put into a box and remain in it for the rest of their lives. They don't need permission to evolve. Women can embody all archetypes and roles they want in their lifetime. The acting and dialogue in the 1939 version is more antiquated, more refined. I love the concentration on costume design, hair and makeup in this film. Each woman's style is very well suited to her temperament and journey. Interesting to see in a pivotal scene, the changing room scene, joancrawford wears a glitzy golden getup, only exposing her legs, which I'm sure at that time was rather risque. And in the matching 2008 scene, evamendes wears a rather sensual lingerie set. So glamorous and telling of the time period for both. Although I really love the styling in the newer version too, very Y2K, both really inspiring from an aesthetic point of view. There's not a single image of a male in both of the movies, not even an extra in the background. Isn't that nice? I wonder how the world would be if that was reality, if the world would be female only, a woman's world. I think this concept is very interesting and original. I think in terms of creative cinematography, set design and costume, the 1939 version takes the win, whereas in terms of inclusivity, the 2008 version does better, as it casts Jada Pinkett Smith and evamendes in vital roles, who obviously are women of color. Although if a third remake would be made now, the casting and character variety would be even more diverse. After all, to be a privileged woman of a high social standing is not exclusive to race. I adore the main cast in both of the movies. As secondary roles, Joan Fontaine, Paulette Goddard, and Lucille Watson appear in the 1939 version, and Deborah Messing, Bette Midler, and Clovis Leachman in the 2008 version. Overall, The Women is a very enticing, provocative, and entertaining look into the lives of a group of women, laced with comedic timing, humorous one-liners, and universal themes. Both versions of The Women are a must-see. Both cast with iconic and award-winning actresses and box office successes, the films are so good to watch and a good lesson on life as a woman in modern day. Many aspects on gender, equality, lifestyle, and values have changed, yet looking into both films proves that being a woman in society is challenging, and when we support one another, life becomes better. The month of March couldn't be more appropriate as a month of celebrating women. It is a month of spring, a month of rebirth, renewal, new energy, new opportunities and adventures blossoming. So spread your wings and fly as high as you desire.